Hi, everyone, and welcome to Oliver Wyman's Reinventing Insurance podcast. I'm your host, Paul Ricard. Welcome to a special edition of the Reinventing Insurance podcast. Our partner team recently gathered for a global meeting in New York, and we held a series of fireside chats with senior leaders in the insurance and asset management industry. My colleague, Lubasha Heredia, a partner focused on the asset management industry, interviewed Joan Lam Tennant. Joan is the chair of the board of directors for AllianceBernstein and Equitable, and she shared valuable perspectives across the insurance and advisory industries. Their conversation covered a range of topics from building successful partnerships, driving innovation, and integrating generative AI into business strategies. Enjoy the conversation.
Well, thank you for joining me here today. We're very excited to have you. You're also obviously very closely involved with AllianceBernstein. So what about challenges in that more traditional, if you will, asset management industry?
In that market, you've got a talent force that has largely grown up in a time of economic prosperity, with compensation structures making it very hard in today's market to maintain margins and meet those compensation structures. And so it's doing things smarter, it's opening markets, and it's more less frictional distribution channels are things that we're very focused on. When Equitable spun off from AXA about 6 or 7 years ago now, one of the ways, and AXA did a fabulous job setting Equitable up for success. It's almost a Harvard Business School case study. I love to write it, because they really set the company up for success. So they sold down on highs as opposed to kitchen sink it. And one of the things they did is collect all their holdings of AllianceBernstein and put it into Equitable, because they thought Equitable needed an asset manager more than they did. So Equitable owns now 61-62% of AllianceBernstein. So I wanted to make that very clear. Now, of course, they're the majority owner, but they're still in owners over and above Equitable. Okay. So that's been, I think, a real advantage for us. And so they, too, are working with Equitable on expanding out their alternative. Well, we just bought CarVal a few years ago, and Equitable put a lot of money behind making that deal close so that Equitable would get access to alternatives properly structured on their balance sheet. And that's just an example of how AllianceBernstein can move in different places but benefit from the partnership or the ownership structure that they have with Equitable.
From a board standpoint, when you look at the management teams and the challenges that the management team's facing today, what do you see as the thing that kind of keeps you up at night, the thing that takes up most of the conversations in the board meetings?
You know, this is not just our management team, but we think about it in terms of our customers at best. And that's overall well-being, defined very broadly. So when we speak about well-being for our employees, we think about their financial well-being, we think about their mental, their physical, and their social well-being. And just think of all the problems that opens up, okay? On financial well-being, we actually started a program for our employees, for our entry-level and support staff employees, where we realized that they had their ability to save and address a emergency need of $1,000 to $2,000 was very limited. And we created vehicles that allowed them to start saving these emergency funds. Well, the good news is that led to their confidence that they could save, and they started like getting massive participation in our 401k. We want them to participate because we want to match it and we want their financial well-being. We're looking at other problems on physical and on mental and social. And of course, social brings up all the issues of hybrid work, return to the office, but under what circumstances. And so I would like to say the thing that we focus on the most as a board for our employees and our customers is well-being, broadly defined. While I define well-being, you understand that I'm not talking about just for a social good, of course for a social good, but with economic consequences for the stakeholders, the owners of Equitable. Like, I don't look at this as an either or, I look at it as a but and. Okay. Mm-hmm. So with that comes the standard answers, like yes. Growth and profitability yes. and efficiency.
How do you think generative AI is going to embed itself into the way we do business in yeah. the retirement yeah. and asset management space?
Generative AI, yeah. That's kind of interesting because we're making significant investments in it and we have democratized it. It's very interesting how some companies are saying thou shall not and putting a lot of controls around it. Obviously, we have controls. So we do the basics, which is create access to our employees once they've qualified. We want to make sure they know what they're doing on a platform that basically safeguards our data. But it's gotten to create a tremendous energy in the company because we're starting to watch how employees are creating efficiencies in the way they're doing business. They know better than anyone. Now, of course, we have the proper safeguards. We do not allow our data to go out into the public market. We allow them to work in a closed environment, but with the access of a defined and dedicated tool for us. And we look at it as kind of having three swim lanes. We look at it as having efficiencies in the way we do business. That one is we're getting a lot of traction in that one just by democratizing access to AI amongst our employees. But we also look at it as better understanding our customer needs and their problems. That'll set our strategy for sure. And the third one is better decision making. And like I said, I think the third one's going to be most difficult. The second one is going to be a subject to how well our customer data is accessible. And there's some work to do there. Innovation is what it will drive success. And so if we emulate it through an insurtech or a fintech, or if we emulate it through a big corporation coming up with a new product, innovation is still here to stay. Right? I think we have to look at how and where we're innovating. I think that's a good place to start. And product innovation is one, but innovating new distribution channels is another. And I've always cringed at innovation for the purpose of stealing market share. Really? There's a whole underserved market out there. Why are we not innovating, to crowd in underserved sectors of this society? Be it the world's poor or be it the working middle class who haven't saved for retirement. Like, why don't we open up bigger markets? So I'd like to think about if we really framed innovation properly and understood what we're innovating and who we're innovating for and what the opportunities would be to solve bigger problems, I think we could be quite successful at it.
You've mentioned employee wellness. You've mentioned how AI impacting the employees and how they do work. You've mentioned talent compensation. So if I take a step back and think about talent more broadly, what do you see as the sort of next set of challenges and opportunities to get the best talent want to work with you and for you?
Now, if you really recognize that talent is the root, it's the engine that drives value for all of your stakeholders, then there's no argument of efforts today that are about developing a culture of inclusiveness as opposed to the focus of it. And so, it starts with a lot of resource groups, but not resource groups that are exclusive to women or exclusive to men. Resource groups that are saying, we're trying to understand the needs of working females. And it's open to all leaders in the organization. And so those type of resource groups, I think, will help drive kind of a inclusive mindset, because it is about creating awareness of the unique aspects of the different sectors of our society.
And what do you think a true partnership looks like since a lot of us have worked with asset managers that historically have focused on themselves, have done everything themselves, and only now starting to venture into figuring out how to work with others.
Yeah, I think a true partnership is where the twosome is really solving a very significant problem for a customer group or a sector of society. And they're bringing to bear what they can do in that partnership. Now, it's got to be economically viable. You know, I'm a capitalist at heart, you know. It's not about charity. It's got to be funded by the engine of capitalism. But the purpose of it and the design of it and the incentives embedded in it have to be all in the customer's best interest, solving a problem for the customer.
And okay, great. So then moving back to retirement, which you've talked a little bit about, and we have been talking about retirement here in different shape or form, and I suspect we'll continue talking about that. What do you see as the most important problems that the retirement industry as an industry is trying to solve today?
In the U.S., just the U.S. alone, we have about 4.1 million individuals retiring between now and 2027. We estimate the retirement gap in the U.S. by 2050 will be $135 trillion. I think about that because, wow, those are the years around 2050 that my daughters will be retiring. And I think about what kind of life they're going to enter into. It won't be their golden years for sure, right? And so I think understanding the how ill-prepared we are as a society for retirement and solving that problem for the mass public is the critical, most important problem to address. And we won't do it alone. So like I said, we have a very solid partnership, you know, with, and perhaps we'll have more. And in fact, we have a team working to expand those partnerships as I speak.
Here you'll see people that work in all different, it's an insurance and asset management practice meeting, and you will see partners from sort of those different industries. And we would love to be relevant. We would love to contribute to the impact and the changes that are happening in this industry. So we would love to hear your advice on where you think a group such as ourselves can be most impactful.
Well, I'd like to start with you are relevant. You are relevant. And that areas that if I would offer some suggestions is it's very easy to go in and solve a micro problem. And then a lot of times you're hired for that, right? Transformation of some sort. But step away from it and think about it in the context of the bigger social problem that you're solving. And understand the clients that you're solving that problem for, what their purpose is. And so how you can think about what you're doing in the context of their customers, right? And I think that would open up tremendous doors. And if you think about what you're doing in the context of the bigger problem you're trying to solve, I think the next and the next and the next engagement is going to be brought to you. So back to the story on really well-being. I think we've made some progress solving the financial well-being. Very little. There's lots more to be done there. But just think about positioning that in the context of holistic well-being, which is really what the populace is asking for today, right? So, you know, find your kind of your North Star, as they will, find what your purpose is, and think about every engagement that you do, how it leads up to a solution on this more broad-based social problem that you're really solving. Now, in the here and now, it's about how do I get efficiencies in this value chain, right? But even that can be reframed, if you will, depending on what value chain you're working and for whom you're solving that problem and for whom will benefit when you solve that problem.
I love that answer that and the part about the purpose of all the things I would like to do. There's probably 2-3 lives in me to be filled with different career paths and different hobbies. I may want to be a university professor. I may want to start a business. I may want to be on a board for an asset manager. And you have managed to do all of those and some in one lifetime. and whatever is to come. So I would love you to walk us through what was the unifying, the driving force behind all of those different career choices and how you thought about them.
Well, thank you for that question, because I know if you read my resume, it does look like a smorgasbord a bit. I started my career as a doctoral student and really set out to understand how risk was being priced, and not just credit and structure, but I got really interested in insurable risk as well. Catastrophic risk, the risk of not having properly saving for your retirement, and on and on. So in a very broad basis of risk, how it was being financed, how it was being priced. I wanted to understand and view how risk is layered and shared in the economy at large, and where it breaks down, where we make decisions, putting risk on the shoulders of men and women who can least afford it. And then furthermore, what are the secondary consequences that have that result in the, let's say, the devaluation of the lives and the livelihoods that they engage. So it really was a problem that I wanted to understand from different vantage points. Maybe I could give a few examples. So, and I'm gonna start with Equitable. Larry Fink and Mark Pearson met 3 years ago. And the problem was, we have gone from defined benefit to defined contributions. And as a result of that, the risk of not saving adequately for your retirement now is on the shoulders of the men and women who can least afford it. Okay. Now, we moved it off the balance sheets of corporates, so they were very happy, but we now have it on the shoulders of the individuals who can least manage it. We did first some real inquiries through Larry Fink. I mean, we really wanted to understand his market and what were the employees of the companies whose 401ks that he managed, what were they asking for? And 89% were asking for guaranteed income in retirement. And it didn't matter, it cut across generations. It didn't matter if it was, you know, Gen Zs, if it was millennials, if it was baby boomers. They all wanted some certainty. So what happened, it's been a three and a half year journey, and we've just kind of reported it to the market. It's gone live. And the title of this innovative product is called Life Path Paycheck. Now, it's not our product. It's Larry's product, right? And what's happened is, because of the SECURE Act, you can embed annuities as a choice alongside of debt and equity in a product we all know, LifePath, that kind of allocates across debt and equity as you mature. Now, it sounds very simple, but it's actually pretty complex to work out the mathematics. The idea was very simple. But what it's done for Equitable, it's allowed us to gain access to the mass market as opposed to just serving the wealth and retirement needs of, say, the top 10%. And we're solving a big problem that we actually created when we moved from defined benefit to defined contribution. And so that's an example. And one more, and that's, yes, Blue Marble. I couldn't help but talk about Blue Marble, which will always have my heart. I started the company in 2014, and I set out to really create financial services, and in particular, an avenue towards risk transfer for the working poor in developing countries. But in essence, what we ended up doing in 2015, we originated our first parametric cover for smallholder farmers in Colombia. And these were coffee growers. And of course, we know today, fast forward 9 more years, parametrics are kind of mainstream a bit. I mean, people know what they are. Back then, it was complex to even get insurers to back it, let alone to get customers to buy it. But I also learned something else, that if we could allow the smallholder farmers around the emerging world to transfer their risk, and we did it properly. We didn't just stop there. We did it in a way that we created incentives that they would make better investments in their business, that they would keep their children in school, that they would have better lives and livelihoods. And that's exactly how we did it. Now, to fast forward the story, I stepped down in, let's say, 2021, But one of the very first individuals I hired is now leading the company. I talk to him from time to time. I'm so proud of him. That program, that very first program that we did, has now got the backing of USAID to be scaled worldwide. So we took it from Latin America to Africa, but now with USAID backing. That story is interesting because we perturbed, you know, a risk, or we created for the first time the ability for the poor to transfer risk. But we also did it through new distribution channels. Like I couldn't just show up in the Caldejas region of Colombia and say, hi, I'm Joan. I needed trust, and I learned that. And the way I got trust is through true partnerships with other participants in their value chain. So we had partnerships with like Nestle Nespresso, who gave us access to the coffee co-ops where they sourced coffee that you and I enjoy. And we had partnerships with NGOs that were lenders, and we had partnerships with input providers as well. And so some of those lessons helped me think about how we established this partnership with Larry and his team, you know, because a partnership is not, let me put my product on your shelf and let's share the proceeds. It's a lot different than that. I will say we did major transformation at Equitable by adopting what's called new ways of working about 4 years ago. And we adopted it right before the pandemic. And I remember the phone call from Mark saying, what are we going to do? Do we go full speed ahead with this or do we back off on it? And he had the courage to go full speed ahead with it. So we have a very different talent model in our organization where we allow teams to focus on problems to be solved, and it's very agile and it's driven by design thinking. And you don't get appointed to be on that team, you raise your hand. And it allows a workforce to solve problems as little as they might be or big as they might be, bringing whatever their skill set is, be it actuarial, be it finance, be it marketing, be it whatever, right? And so that has created a new sense of energy and passion to innovate in our organization because innovation is democratized. You just raise your hand, right? We are looking on ways to expand our embedded solution in 401ks. But it was a new ways of working team that resolved the mathematics of that problem over the last 3 years. And it was a really cross-functional team. They weren't all mathematicians on that team. One of them who led it, by the way, was someone who had his roots in Oliver Wyman. He was our chief risk officer, and he joined us from Oliver Wyman. So that's why I say you are relevant.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to this special edition of the Reinventing Insurance Podcast. Talk again soon. For more information about our Reinventing Insurance series, you can find everything on our website at oliverwyman.com/reinventinginsurance. Thanks for listening, and I'll see you next time.